Welcome. Glad you've decided to join us today for a study in Isaiah. We're going to be in Isaiah chapter 25 today. So if you've got a Bible, I would encourage you to grab that and to join in with us. You know, some of what we looked at so far has been pretty dreadful. Judgment on the nation of Israel, judgment on the nations. Things just don't look good in some of the chapters that we looked at. But today is a turning point. It's a great day of salvation for the nation of Israel, but also for all nations. And it shows the comprehensiveness of God's love and compassion. Yes, for Israel as His chosen people, but also for the world. He is God of all. And He extends salvation to all and desires that all men be saved. And we see that today in these verses. And so let's start off and in chapter number 25, and we'll look at verses 1 through 10. Chapter 25, verses 1 through 10. O Lord, You are my God. I will exalt You. I will praise Your name, for You have done wonderful things. Your counsels of old are faithfulness and truth. One of the first things that jumps out, He says, You are my God. So it's very, very personal. And it reminds us that even though God is God of all the universe, He cares about and wants to have a relationship with each one of us individually. One commentator said, the singer, this is a song that we're looking at. The singer says, I want to be like You. I want a being like You for my God. I want to belong to one as powerful and faithful as You. You have shown me that You truly belong to me because You have not abandoned me to the oppressor. You have kept faith with me when I was so afraid You had forgotten me. You are my God. And man, that's a good word for all of us, that He is our God. Once we become a child of His, once we accept His gift of salvation, He is our God. We are His children. It says You've done wonderful things. And that language is typically used for supernatural things. And so the singer of this song is saying, you're not constricted by the things that we can do or that humans can do. You rule the universe. And so nothing's impossible for You. And so that's the kind of God that he's talking about. That's the kind of God certainly I want on my side. It speaks of His sovereign power and dedication to His plans. It says, Your counsels are of old. And so what He's saying is, you've been faithful in the past. I know You're going to be faithful in the future. And all these things that are happening are a part of Your ultimate plan. And you know, in the days that we are seeing in our country right now, that ought to be a good word for us. Even though it seems like things are just crumbling around us, God's in control. We don't always see that. We don't always understand that. But He is guiding things according to His purposes and according to His plan. Look at verse 2. For You have made a city a ruin, a fortified city a ruin, a palace of foreigners to be a city no more. It will never be rebuilt. And so here in those chapters that we've looked at before, chapter 23, chapter 13, it talked about the pride of the nations, the arrogance of the nations. And this is just a reminder that God is going to bring them low. They've not looked at Him. They've not feared Him. They've not submitted to Him. So He's going to bring them low. And He's going to completely wipe them out and they'll never be rebuilt. Let's look at verse 3. Therefore, the strong people will glorify You. the city of the terrible nations will fear you. So even though he brings these nations low, it says that the people of those nations will glorify him. And, you know, you think, well, exactly what does that mean? What are we getting to here? Again, let's remember, he's the God of all peoples. And whoever accepts him and brings him into their life, he'll receive them and make them part of his family. And so it's a picture that even though the Hebrews were his chosen people, and even though sometimes these nations around them abuse the Hebrews, still he loves them and has compassion for them. And if those people, even individuals in that nation, will accept him, then he will bring them in his family. One of my favorite verses in Revelation chapter 7 says the same thing. After these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, peoples, tongues, standing before the throne of the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hand, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God and sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And it goes on and says, and the angels were saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom, thanksgiving, honor and power and might be to our God forever. So when we get to heaven, there's going to be people of every nation, of every tribe, there together glorifying God. And that's what this verse 3 is talking about. Look at verse 4. For you have been a strength to the poor, a strength to the needy in her distress, a refuge from the storm, a shade from the heat. For the blast of the terrible ones is a storm against the wall. You'll reduce the noise of the aliens as heat in a dry place, as heat in the shadow of a cloud. The song of the terrible ones will be diminished. God brings down the prideful, number one, because they're arrogant and they don't recognize his reign over them. But he also brings them down because of their arrogance and the way they treat other people. If we're a prideful person, if pride's a problem in our life, we're going to tend to look at disdain on people that we consider lower than us. And when we disdain people, typically we treat them badly. And God has always been for the poor. God has always been for the weaker. And so he's going to bring those nations down because of the way they've treated him, but also because of the way that they've treated people. Because God is all about the well-being of humanity. And when nations or when peoples treat others badly, he's going to bring them down. I thought this was a great quote from J.N. Oswald. It says, the genius of Hebrew religion is its capacity to weld together an almighty, transcendent creator with an intimate, personal father. Neither one of these alone will do, but no other religion has been successful in holding the two together. God is our refuge and our strength. In other words, he's where we can go safety. We can go for safety. We can be protected, but he's also our strength. He is all powerful. He can handle anything that comes his way. Let's look at verse 6. And in this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all people a feast of choice pieces, a feast of wine on the lees, of fat things full of marrow, of well-refined wines on the lees. And he will destroy on this mountain the surface of the covering cast over all peoples and the veil that has spread over all the nations. So here's the picture of a great banquet that God is coming to to provide this for his people, not just for Israel. You notice it says the Lord of hosts will make for all people. And he talks about Feast of the Wine of the Lees, or in other words, the very best wine, the wine that they reserve for only special occasion. And he says, he calls the fat things full of marrow. And that was the, if you remember in the sacrificial system, the pieces of meat that had the fat on them were typically reserved for God because they were the most flavorful. They were the most valuable that were there. And so all of that was picturing that when God brings all of his people home there, when we get to heaven, there'll be people from every nation and he will provide for us. The whole idea of this big banquet, yes, speaks to the future provision of God when we're with him, but it also speaks to the way that he provides for us every day of our life, and that we've always seen that that faithfulness. Think about that. The Almighty God of the universe takes care of you and me. He provides for you and me. Maybe not everything we want, but certainly everything that we need and even more. Let's look at verse 8. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord of God will wipe away tears from all faces, the rebuke of his people. He will take away from the earth, for the Lord has spoken. And it will be said in that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him, and he will save us. This is our Lord. We have waited for him. We will be glad and rejoice in his salvation. And so the banquet's amazing. It's got the best of everything, the best wine, the best food, the best that anyone could ever want. But it goes beyond that. It says that he'll destroy the veil, or he'll swallow up the covering. And that covering was the veil of mourning. When someone died, they'd cover their faces in mourning. And so what it's saying is that God's going to destroy death. He's going to take that away. And not only that, but it says he'll wipe away our tears. Certainly we cry when someone dies, but it's talking about the other maladies of life as well. Sickness, disappointment, hurt, whatever it is, God's going to wipe those away. And man, what an amazing picture that is. That sovereign God stoops down to wipe the tears away. It's a picture of a superior being coming down and wiping the tears away from a child. And that's how God cares for us. He cares for us individually. And when we hurt, he wants to help us through that. You know, whether it's death, financial trouble, family troubles, whatever it is, God will walk along with that. And if we'll lean on him, he will guide us through that and help us through that. But God is going to conquer death for all people and for everyone who considers him part of them. But it also says he'll take away the rebuke of his people. Sin brings shame on a people. Sin brings shame on you and I. And God's going to take that away. God's going to wash that sin away out of our life. Isaiah said that in chapter 1. He says, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they will be as white as snow. Though they are like red crimson, they shall be as wool. C.V. Smith said, when people are reproached, they are objects of derision, mockery, shame, and humiliation by others. These evil actions will not be experienced any longer in God's kingdom. If the enemies of God are defeated, they will no longer be people to give reproach, and there will be no sinful people who deserve to be reproached. So when we get to heaven, all that's over with. We've all done things that we're embarrassed about, that we're ashamed about. But when we get to heaven, when we're with God, He's going to wipe all that away. Finally, let's look at verse 10. For on this mountain the hand of the Lord will rest, and Moab shall be trampled down under him, as straw is trampled down for the refuse heap. Moab here is used as an example of a prideful, arrogant people. And it says God is going to bring them down. You know, when I was growing up and working on my granddaddy's ranch, one of the jobs I hated the most was cleaning out the stalls in the barn. And if you've ever been on a farm or ever been around an animal, you know that when you keep animals in a closed-in area for any amount of time, the ground under them just becomes a pit of mire and manure. And I mean, it's not something that you want to be in. But that's the picture here, is that arrogant people, arrogant nations, are going to be trampled under like straw. They're just going to bend and break and become part of that nasty mess that's in a manure pile. That's the picture of what's going to happen to those nations. That's the picture of what God's judgment does to people and to nations when they reject Him, when they refuse to humble themselves to Him. That's not something I want to be part of, and I'm sure you don't either. This was a difficult time for the Israelites. The nations around them were coming in on them. They didn't think they could withstand the forces that were coming. They didn't know what was going to happen. It's like their world was crumbling around them. Well, when you look at our nation and some of the stuff that's going on around us, and we look at both political parties and we say, you know, one may be a little bit better than what, and maybe a little closer to what I want for our nation, but neither is an example of the kind of people that God wants us to be. We could get real depressed and be real downcast about the direction of our nation, but that's not where our hope is. Our hope is in Jesus Christ. And regardless of what goes on in the United States or in the world, He's going to provide for us. He's going to protect us. Not a politician, not a political party, not a government. We have the Almighty God of the universe looking out for us every day. That's all we need to know, and we can place our faith in Him. Hope you'll join me next week as we continue through Isaiah. Thank you.